Hi everybody, welcome to our 12th episode of In Discussion With series. Before I get into an introduction about everyone that we have on our panel today, I would first like to give a shout out to all of you who've been a part of our journey throughout. The fact that we've been able to successfully conduct 11 episodes and the fact that we have a distinguished panel today with us has only been made possible because of your support and motivation. Thanks a lot, and we really hope that you will keep showering your support and blessings. Getting into the discussion for the day, I'm Sakshi Soi. I'm the founder of Prowess Learning and Consulting and a certified Scrum Master. I come with extensive experience about 10 plus years in market research, project management in the data analytics field, project director in the education technology field, and training program management. Sometime around January this year, I decided to bring all of this experience together and relaunch or revive our brand called Prowess, with one mission in mind: to make education and knowledge accessible and reachable to everyone that we can. With this mission, there are three aspects that we are focusing on. One is our In Discussion With series. This is a series that we do or we conduct every Saturday at 7 p.m. In this, we bring speakers from diverse backgrounds together to share their experience and knowledge on several burning topics. We have already covered a lot of different topics, ranging from human rights, LGBTQ rights, L&D areas, economy, trade, STEM education, and so on and so forth. And we hope that we will continue to address a lot of more burning questions. The second aspect that we focus on is live online training. The area, the whole focus over here is to make sure it's an experiential learning for participants, where through the entire duration of the course, you're not just learning conceptually, theoretically, how to solve a problem, but also applying that knowledge. The third aspect that we cover is corporate and colleges. So while our live online training sessions are open for bulk bookings as well, and they are open to corporate and colleges, we take up specific training requirements and needs from organizations and universities alike. We convert them into content and deliver it in a method that's most suitable for the training need. So that's a little bit about Prowess and what we do over here. And we hope that you will continue joining our journey as we go forward. All right, so getting into the topic for the day, we will be talking about disruption and transformation in higher education with a big focus on impact on quality. And for this, our co-host for today is Dr. Neha Sharma. She's a director at Shanti Business School, Ahmedabad. She has extensive experience of working with public and private organizations alike to enhance capacity building programs to enable upskilling of the workforce. She has been a lead consultant to MIDC, MMRDA, ICICI, and several more organizations. She's a certified trainer of 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. I'm sure all of you have heard of the book, even if you haven't read it. And she's also a certified trainer of SPIN model of sales management. Welcome, Dr. Neha.
Thank you, Sakshi. Thanks a lot.
Moving on to our list of panelists. Our first panelist for the day is Dr. Ramesh Kasetkar. He's the founder of BSK Institute of Quality Consciousness. Dr. Ramesh is a retired colonel, former army officer, and he is heavily focused on quality consciousness. With this mission in mind, he's also a managing trustee at Quality Plus. He's been a former vice chancellor at 2 universities and completed his doctorate also in a related subject. Welcome, Dr. Kasetkar. Next, we have Dr. Madhukar B.S. with us. He's been a member at NAC for a very long time. And during his tenure with NAC, he was a founder and director of University of Mumbai's Quality Assurance Cell. His focus on quality enhancement has been immense. He is currently a member of the Assessment Committee of Yoga Certification Board, Ministry of Ayush, and has also received Endeavor Executive Award from the Government of Australia. Welcome, Dr. Madhukar. Then we have Dr. P.K. Aluwalia with us. He is a former professor of physics at Himachal Pradesh University. He's been a member of the Himachal Pradesh State Higher Education Council and on the advisory committee of Private University Education Regulatory Commission at HP, Himachal Pradesh. He was awarded with Commonwealth Academic Fellowship at Edinburgh University, UK, and has been felicitated with the Environment Leadership Award in 2017 by the government of Himachal Pradesh. A former director, Internal Quality Assurance Cell, Himachal Pradesh, Shimla. Welcome, sir. And finally, we have with us Dr. Jawahar Nason. He's a Vice Chancellor of JSS Science and Technology University, Mysuru, a former Vice Chancellor of Savita University, Chennai. He comes with extensive experience of working across several continents, from North America, Europe to Asia. He's also worked with several titles as a teacher, professor, researcher, and so on. And owing to this experience, he's been invited by several universities and committees to help them further their strategic goals and objectives. He was invited by a university in Malaysia to help them become the top university by 2020. He was also nominated by CIDB, Construction Industry Development Board, at Malaysia as an advisor. Welcome, Dr. Jawahar.
Thank you. Thank you, Sakshi.
With this, I would like to invite Dr. Neha to take over the discussion further with the first question and topic. Ma'am.
Thanks again, Sakshi, and thanks to Provis for bringing together this illustrious panel of highly acclaimed academicians on a very important topic of disruption and transformation in higher education, its impact on quality. As we go into the discussion, I would like to start with a quote by saying, quote, knowledge and skills are replacing money to become 21st century's most valuable currency, unquote. However, every currency in global market is pegged at different levels. And similarly, the value of knowledge as a currency depends on the strength of the foundation or the bedrock on which it is laid. And in this case, it is the quality of education. We all know that there are several factors that come together to ensure quality of education. As we begin our discussion for the day, I would like to ask all the panel members that if you were to identify one most important factor which critically impacts the quality of higher education, what it would be? I would request the panel members to take this question one after the other. I invite Professor Ramesh Kasatwa to take it and begin the discussion. While Professor Kasatwa is coming online, may I ask Professor Madhukar Jadhav to kindly take up the question for the panel.
Thank you, Dr. Neha. I think I'm happy for this opportunity to share my thoughts on this. In fact, I have been working in this quality area for almost 20 years and visited institutions across India. My viewpoint is largely based on the Indian higher education system. I could first look at, in case it is left to me, what is the two factors I undo? I could call it as the undo factors, which are very important in my opinion. The first factor is the evaluation system we follow in this country. And the second is about localization. Let me, since we have to take one important one, I will just elaborate a little on the localization issue. See, when you look at any ranking, you look at maybe the recent ones like QS ranking, even NIRF ranking, you see the top 10 or top 20. I have my reservations on this ranking, but apart from that, when you look at some top 15 or 20 universities across the world or the highly rated ones, even in India, there is one striking factor in all this. That is, you can easily see there is what is called as faculty diversity and student diversity in this institution. It is a striking factor. Now, what is happening in our systems? We have, in fact, closed doors on this. In fact, many of our universities and universities particularly, instead of being universal or attracting students from all parts of the, forget about world, all parts of the countries, it is not becoming possible. So we are becoming, we are localizing our education, which is, maybe it's intangible, but it has a serious effect on quality. I can vouch for it. I've visited thousands of institutions. But when you enter an institution where there is faculty diversity and student diversity, that the institution has vibrancy. There is no doubt this can be felt. It is something you feel when you enter that campus. So I think what we really have to do is, I think we have somehow have to bring this as a basic. Forget about improving quality and other issues of accreditation, etc. We have to set the base right. Somehow we have to, all of, particularly our state universities, if you look at, in fact, they have leave Delhi apart for some for this discussion. Many of the universities, they have localized to such an extent that two districts or three districts is a catchment area. And that cannot be a university, particularly in the state, except for the deemed universities and private universities, which is coming up, which does have an all India kind of a flavor. I think we need to look at this intangible very seriously and try to undo this. At least now with the technology coming to our aid, I think we have to work at least base model. I call it as a base phenomenon. As a base phenomenon, we have to rework this strategy so that we will bring diversity into our campus. I know in colleges in some part of the country, the faculty selection is limited to district. It is so much politicalized that you cannot have a faculty from a different district of a same state. It is a very, I think we have to get rid of what is called as a closed mentality, at least in the area of education. Because I feel in a college, if there is a faculty and member, if there is no Singh, if there is no Sen Gupta, if there is no Gowda, there is no Talwar, I think our quality will not go up. That is one point. Evaluation, I leave it. I have a strong opinion even on our evaluation system. So since it is to be, one is to be taken, I think I've consumed my 4 minutes. Is it?
Right.
So with that, I stop and I request the panel also and others who are participants to reflect on this issue. Thank you.
Yes, very well said. Localization is becoming akin to inbreeding and killing the quality of higher education. This is what Professor Madhukar reflected upon. May I now request Professor Ramesh Kasatwa to take the question? We have Professor Jawahar Nissen online. So, sir, I would request for your opinion on one critical aspect of higher education quality.
I think that, thank you, Dr. Neha, and thank you, Sakshi, for inviting me. And also, I'd like to thank all my colleague panel members. When you look at the education in India, you cannot just judge by its performance by just one critical factor. There are a lot of things involved, but I would like to take the issue of subject matters of instruction. See, when you look at the quality in education, the quality lies in the way in which education, the subject matters, the manner in which the subject matters of instruction are derived and handled during the learning process. Say, the subject matters of instruction nowadays have been highly politicized. By that way, education has become politics now. And the nation state on one hand, and those in the higher strand of the society on the other hand, and from the third angle, the neoliberal market forces. They are all deciding the subject matters of instruction. I mean the contents of the delivery process during the learning. And what they do, they are trying to, influence the subject matters of instruction, which are monopolized by these three bodies. So unless education is liberated from these three forces, and education.
Internet name. They're not able to see you.
Yes.
Professor Nason was of the view that subject matter, what we teach at the university.
The second stage of the. Hello.
Is at the center stage.
Yes.
It is the lifeblood.
Yes.
It is the lifeblood of from where the quality of education is derived.
Let me conclude
it. Yes.
Hello, can you all hear me?
Yeah, we can. We can, sir. I would come back to Professor Nason for his concluding remark on the subject matter of instruction. But before that, I would like to hear from Professor P.K. Ahluwalia about his view on quality of education, the most critical factor which resonates with him.
Thank you very much, Dr. Neha and Sakshi, to be part of this discussion. I missed a bit because of the internet glitches, but as yet, when we are thinking in terms of education, tangible, so tangible, and there are lots of things which remain not tangible. And when I say this because of different reasons. Reasons is that when we are talking of quality, we are talking about quality from whose point of view? Is it the sense? What do we mean when a student looks at the quality? What do we mean when we look at the quality? What do we mean when the employers look at the quality? What do we mean when the
So the third point of view on quality of higher education was that the quality depends on the perspective from whose perspective are we looking at, which stakeholder is looking at the quality. And then within that, there are tangibles and intangibles to be noted. I'm very sure we will get the perspective of Dr. Ahluwalia when we proceed ahead in the discussion. Dr. Ramesh Kasatwar, I would like to know your views, sir, on one critical factor which impacts the quality of higher education in India.
Impacting the functioning and system of higher education. The first, we have to accept that today, as on date, the quality of education, first presumption we have to accept it. And the politicians and bureaucrats are making so much of noise about quality that the quality, exact quality level is not known to anybody. Okay, anyhow, they cannot be one factor, they can be a couple of factors. I would like to say the first important factor which is impacting the quality is rampant commercialization and lack of vigilance. Topmost in my mind, it is coming up. Rampant commercialization because of the so many issues are there. Okay, second point. The validation of quality has been hijacked from the student by everyone else. I think the most important stakeholder in the system of higher education is the student. And only student is not allowed to quality. Everybody is trying to express the quality in their own way for their own benefit. Promoters and teachers and everybody else. Government-owned institutions are not responsive to the need of the hour today. They have their own thought process, they have their own speed. I don't think the experience says they are not responsive to the need of the hour today. Even if you want to do something into the content of the syllabus, I don't think dominant is the last chapter I'd like to say words only. Assurance of 100% student is not demanded even by the statutory body today. The statutory bodies are silent today. Let's take a NAC, you take UGC.
Sir Ahluwalia, since you are back on the visual with us, would you like to elaborate on the tangible and intangible aspects of that you were talking about before you left?
So I was actually talking about the kind of heterogeneity which is there in the higher education institutions. So when you talk of quality, you know, this heterogeneity itself is not allowing us to really have the kind of quality which is needed. And this is, I think, one of the very important issues in whole of the scenario. And I think we can ever bridge this. However, you know, when we are in terms, if we go in the setup of each and every higher education institution,
yes,
I think we are not tuned towards quality in any way.
Right.
We talk of quality only when the regulator wants to sometimes. Otherwise, we are not at all worried about the quality. I think that is a very, very, you know, realistic scenario which is there. And we need to really look at these things. As I was saying, there are things which are tangible, there are certain things which are not so tangible, and there are certain things which are not at all tangible. For example, tangible thing is what? There is one issue which is impacting quality in a very big way, and that is the qualified faculty in the higher education institutions. If you look at today the scenario, you will find that almost 100% higher education institutions are having 50% faculty there in terms of availability to the students. Otherwise, what we are doing is, you know, we are to bridge gaps by hiring some faculty and not having that kind of perm faculty in the campuses in quality. Because I believe quality comes from individuals. Individuals are very crucial in the context of the quality. If they are absent, I think nothing will operate.
Thank you.
And this thank you very need much. To look very, very, funding is a very important issue. Thank you.
Thank you very much. After looking at the factors which the members think are critical to quality, let's move on. Sakshi,
Thank you so much.
You are on camera constantly. No, you're gone.
For sharing your view on what are the key factors that impact quality. Unfortunately, we are facing a little bit of trouble in terms of technology. It doesn't always work with us as smoothly as we would want it to. But moving on to the next question. So we are all between a crisis, right, of COVID-19 that has hit us, which has caused several disruptions in the education sector. If we were to highlight one or two major disruptions due to the pandemic that are hitting the quality of education being provided to the students today, we've moved from on-campus to live training sessions on different technology platforms. I would want to invite Dr. Jawahar over here to share your views about what are the challenges, one or two key challenges that we are facing that are impacting quality due to the pandemic today.
Yeah, thank you. I'm sorry, I lost the way somewhere. Somehow the connection was lost and then it was back. Before answering that question, I would like to just to conclude what I discontinued there. One or 2 minutes, and then I will switch on to this second question. Say, when I said that there are three major forces governing the way by which education is handled these days all over the world, based on the desires of the society, those who are controlling the society, based on the desires of the those who are at the helm of the affairs in the state, national state, and especially the neoliberal market forces. They are dictating what the skills are, what the knowledge is. And based on that, we are all the university, the educational system is narrowed down to a point in a very simple, very, very illogical manner that the curriculum is designed and the educational objectives are drafted, are formulated. So that means that, are we satisfying the needs of the customer? Who is our customer? The customer in education is the society. It is the people of the country. It is the learner who is going to take being groomed in this country relevantly to the situation, to the conditions of the society, to the conditions of the country, to the conditions of the region, based on which the contents and the subject matters of instruction should be derived, should be harvested from the society. And the education should reflect the society's societal demand and the sectoral demands, the economic sectoral demands, and the national priorities. But who decides the priority of the nation? And few people are desiring for. So similarly, these economic forces, I mean the neoliberal economic forces, the market forces, in a very narrow way, in their own selfish way, they are deciding this is the skill, this is the knowledge, and based on their influence, most of the educational objectives, the program objectives are designed. So that means if quality is satisfying the demands of the customer of the education, the educational process, and if we are going to deliver and satisfy somebody else away from the society, somebody else away from the general mass, then the basic question here is we don't have virtually any quality whatsoever in the way in which we deliver education, especially in this part of the world, in India. I think that this must be stopped at once. And it has to be, that's why I always used to say that education should be brought back and put in the center stage of the society. Only then education will do its intended job. So that is what I wanted to just conclude. In continuation to the second question, this pandemic has been a boon. I wrote an article, sometimes I think my friends would have read there, whether the alternate mechanisms by which we deliver education in this country are really serving or really doing the intended business of education or intended purpose of education. I said it is not. Education is derailed and it is an excuse. COVID-19 is an excuse. And now there are people flooding all educational institutions in the name of online learning. And they say that online learning is the savior of education. And they try to replace online learning, the basic learning process and educational process by online learning altogether. saying that is a pedagogy in the way in which we instruction. The instructions are the learning. The instructions are handled in the educational system, and that pedagogy already has been lost. Pedagogy already has been not there in our educational process. It is just a rote system, and that is a content-based, content-oriented delivery process. And people are not allowed to think, and students are highly oppressed in this country, and they cannot question, they cannot reflect on the knowledge and the information they encounter in the learning process or in the classroom. Already a physical face-to-face educational process, the learning process is already, you know, not, is disabled to go through the process of education. Now there is a remote connectivity, you know, being replaced. And a remote connectivity is enforced, and people are somewhere in different, you know, locations. And we try to say that we are going to deliver education. As long as online education can address the real educational process, yes, I am there to accept. Yes, we should do that. But in online education, all pedagogical interventions and mechanisms cannot happen 100%. You can go for some blended learning, say partially some dynamic issues related to learning process. You can connect to the rest of the world. You can connect to the experts. You can connect to the society. You can connect to the diverse entities involved in the learning process. But the basic question of learning lies in the process of the pedagogy by which you deliver or you enable or you facilitate the learning process. I think that that pedagogical interventions, we don't have the technology as of yet. And as Dr. Madhukar said, it is one of the finest things that he said, that it must be diverse. The learning process must be diverse for you to be innovative and for you to reflect, to be reflective of your encounter with the knowledge or information during the learning process. You have to be diverse. So he said many different walks of life in this country. There are a lot of people, so in terms of, caste, creed, religion, and poverty, rich, there are a lot of diverse mass there. And people are having a different exposure and a different encounters in their livelihoods and all their endeavors. So that means education must be able to cultivate all those endeavors. And education, the knowledge, must be able to, address all those endeavors. And then only it can be called a pure, knowledge. So your knowledge, if it is one-sided and not testified, and it is not universal, how can I say it is a pure knowledge? A knowledge is always universal. If 1 + 1 = 2, that means it is 2 in United States and India as well. That means your knowledge, in a narrowly way you define, based on your own sectoral observations, you cannot say it is knowledge. So that means knowledge must have a diverse perspective. Unless all diverse learners are involved in the learning process or in the knowledge productivity, in terms of research, in terms of learning, in terms of reflecting the learning process insightfully. So all those things should happen. So that means knowledge evolves, a universal knowledge evolves, and it is accepted only when it comes from a diverse, background, where in India, in the name of all different walks of life with watertight compartments, the thought process is segregated in a different way. The education has failed to cultivate all those processes. If you can do it in online or other alternate modes, you do it. But I don't see anything. Already we are facing a lot of problems in the face-to-face learning process. The greatest challenge we face is, again, as I told you, the three major factors influencing this sector: the nation state, which governs education based on its own desire, the neoliberal market force, and those who are controlling the society from the upper strata. And based on these, the desires of these three segments of the society, and they are really controlling and influencing the education. And the challenge here is, taking advantage of the COVID-19, they are trying to put their agenda. For instance, I'm flooded with so many people so many service providers online, you know, with online technologies. And those technologies, of course, technology is there. But is it possible to, as Dr. Madhukar said, is it possible to have a diverse learning process in learning process? If it is possible through online, yes. But it is not just getting here and there, few people online and getting the ideas and assimilate it. But it must be real. They must be able to reflect. They must be able to question. And they must be able to assimilate ideas and reflect the ideas with whatever they encounter during the learning process. If it happen, yes, it is. And where is the social justice? If about more than 60% of the people have no computers and connectivities in India, and where is the solution for it? This is the major challenge. We are not able to conduct examinations. But the government of India, with the UGCs and many other, you know, regulatory authorities, are just somehow asking us, somehow you go and do the examination and complete it. How is it possible? And when 60% of people do not have computers and lack of connectivities, how are we going to do online examinations? And when our borders of all states and districts are closed, how are we going to invite the students across the nation to the university and conduct the examination physically in the campus? Neither physically can we do, and nor can we do by online because of the lack of technologies. And even if the technologies are there, who on earth can with all guarantee tell that we have an online examination system, that mechanism can be applied with a foolproof system so that we can testify the knowledge, the desirable knowledge and skills supposed to be achieved by the students during the learning process? And there is nothing like that in this country or elsewhere whatsoever. There are some major bodies from Stanford universities, Harvard universities, they are also freely offering some courses. They are just only visual-based courses. The visualization through online cannot replace the real learning process. That is very important. I know very much there are people who are telling me 11 weeks course by those competitive service providers, people have done it in 3 days. People have done it in 3 days. They have completed all the modules. Does it mean that they have learned? Not is the question. They are not learning. Unless you are able to assess the outcomes, the learning outcomes, the desirable, the knowledge and skills, unless you achieve it, you cannot say that you have achieved on this. And there are a lot of hue and cry and lot of enthusiasm showed on online learning process, which has to be carefully addressed in this country, because this country has a varied, diverse, a completely diverse altogether amongst in the world. And when we are going for online, and especially when we handle education and with all the curriculum structures that in a desirable way, we have to be very much careful. One, Dr. Madhukar asked me to comment that he said that the diverse learning, in United Kingdom, there was a committee commissioned by the parliament. They studied it. They said that innovation, critical thinking happens only when people of different walks of life sit together and learn. Can online education do that? That we have to make it in this country in the physical learning process, that we have failed to do it because we are highly a segregated community in this part of the world. And we have to just reclaim, in order to achieve education properly, to enable it, to render its intended purpose, we have to address, tweak the educational process altogether and align the society with the educational process. Educational process should be, revisited so that it harvest and cultivate the reflections of all walks of life, so that all human endeavors are reflected in the educational learning process and the knowledge is achieved. I think
very
I will
rightly,
give more time.
Very,
thank you very much.
Very rightly said here. We would like to hear the opinion of Professor Ramesh Kasapar on this, that how COVID has impacted and exposed the shortcomings of Indian education.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Neha. Yeah, definitely all of us know that it has caused a lot of disruption in the system of higher education. It has affected teaching, it has affected learning, and also it has affected the evaluation system also, entire system. Now let's see how it has affected various stakeholders. Let's not talk about the philosophy. It has affected the various stakeholders. They look at this appendage. Promoters of higher education institution. I'm not talking about the government. Now they're all aware about the admissions. That is the source of money for everybody. So the promoters of higher education are worried today about loss of admission because of pandemic. Okay. Next stakeholder, very, very important stakeholder, parents. Can the system today, the politics or the government or any system, give assurance of security of the children when they come to college? This is the big issue. Now, a lot of people have discussed with me, in the parliament can be online, there are no e-schooling, how can the colleges be online? Very difficult, so teachers, parents are worried about this. Teachers, they all are baffled due to non-availability of suitable pedagogy for online teaching. About 10 days back, I conducted a long, long session, about 90-minute session for engineering college teachers. Do we have the structured pedagogy for online teaching today? Jawahar, I was speaking to Dr. Jawahar also, I spoke to Madhukar. All of us, it is very, very clear that today Indian system is not prepared. It is not ready for online teaching. Let's accept it. Let's not copy foreign countries. Let's not copy what happens in Harvard or there or IIT or I'm not. I talk about the 80% colleges in India, 80%. All in rural India. Let's accept that. Okay. Next comes a very, very important stakeholder of system of higher education. Students. Most baffled today. They are most affected, worst affected stakeholder is the student today. Imagine one small example. There is no exam. They are promoted. There was a cartoon a couple of days back. One student goes for interview. And he's asked the question, which batch you are from graduation? He said 2020. He was rejected outrightly because there was no exam for him in 2020. He carries the stigma throughout his life. Now, online, R has mentioned very categorically, are we accustomed by e-learning today? Learning through e is very, very difficult today. Let's not go on a metro cities or tier 2 cities. Let's think about them. 80% colleges located across India, rural India. Go to remote Andhra Pradesh, go to remote Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Orissa, all very difficult, very, very difficult for them. The most important question, we are talking about online. Pandemic has forced us to go online today. Okay, let's go. Like non-availability or stability of internet connectivity. Let's come back to very normal brass tack on-ground reality. Can government of India provide stable and stable internet connectivity? Jawahar just mentioned 60% students do not have computer or laptop. Then this suddenly happened from 22nd March onward. It has suddenly happened in India. We are asked to change. All of us were asked, forced to change. Are we ready for a change? Are we ready for a shift in our paradigm to do online learning? Now, online learning brings a lot of dilution. When there is a difficulty in learning on face-to-face system, you can imagine the dilution it would take on online learning. Because the student may switch on the computer, switch on if it is available, and that's the end of it. The teachers are not able to guess the student reaction online teaching. I think the worst affected today are the students from a technical courses. Let's say engineering. Forget about a BA, BCom, or I'm not trying to say, but worried about the engineering technical courses where more than 50% learning takes place by practical. We know that it is called kinesthetic way of learning. It is not happening today. So now there is a yes, no doubt about it, pandemic has definitely caused a lot of disruption in learning system. We'll have to come out systematically. Like Jawahar just mentioned, we keep on talking every second day. UGC is forcing, AICT is forcing. It is putting down the throat, you do this, you do this. Not sitting in air-conditioned offices in Delhi or somewhere else does not mean that you make compulsory learning, compulsory teach. People can do maximum cover the syllabus. Covering means what? Has the learning taken place? Are the student happy? Have you asked the student, are you happy about the online teaching? We are forgetting the basics of the system of higher education in the learning. So I think I will conclude my remarks here that pandemic has definitely affected the basic purpose of system of higher education is the learning. It is not happening. If it happens, it is getting diluted.
So we have heard from Dr. Thank you very much, Dr. Ramesh and Dr. Jawahar. We have heard from you, and it conclusively states that higher education in ways have derailed during COVID. And in a move to correct it, a one-size-fits-all solution in the form of online education is being provided today. But we say that challenges, as they say, also come along with opportunities for new solutions, for innovations, and for larger disruptions, which may stay for longer, even after the situation of crisis has passed away. So, Dr. Ahluwalia, if you would like to tell, you would tell our audience how these pitfalls or weaknesses that are currently plaguing our higher education, how can they be addressed by the institutions of higher education in such a situation? How can we ensure at our end that education without disruption continues and at least the quality, if not better, which was being delivered pre-COVID, reaches the doorsteps of the students and they do not suffer? Dr. Ahluwalia.
Okay, thank you very much. In fact, you know, one thing has happened. This COVID has come as a kind of a, you know, magnifying glass to look at our educational system. Interesting thing. We are seeing now that which are the parts which are actually bursting, not ready for this kind of stuff. It has happened. And, you know, suddenly what stopgap, you know, situation was there. Teachers were told, you know, you get online, you have internet to interact with the students. And really searching for the kinds of needed for online interventions. They were not exposed to these kinds of ideas, though in our country, there are lots of resources which are available today. I would say you don't need to create your own resources. There are already there which really bank upon, which have been created using learning management systems, a four-quadrant approach, all assessment, etc., interwoven into that. But we are not knowing about all those things. You know, that was the drawback which was there. In one of the, you know, brainstorming sessions in one of the institutions in my city, people asked me, is there a way out that when we do not have the kinds of resources, how can we proceed? I gave them a very interesting, simple solution in with. I think that is one of the best ways to look at. And that was to go ahead with creating your own course from the existing resources which are available to us free of cost. I think these are available at e-Pathshala level, at e-UG Pathshala level, at e-PG Pathshala level. You go to these sites, you will find there are lots of resources by good experts are available to us. So now what is solution? I say a simple thing. You try to make a Word document with it, which is of trying. First is the serial number. Second is you write down the units and subunits of your syllabus, which we deliver. After that, add learning objectives in the third column. Professor Jawahar was talking about, we are not very clear about these things. We don't enter these kinds of exercises in a routine fashion. After that, go on the internet itself, you will find two kinds of resources which are available there. One is what is known as the e-text. Other is the videos. For each of the topics, you know, you can always try e-text, give the links in the the fourth column, and in the fifth column you give what you call the video links of those topics itself. What are we going to do? The next column is for assessment. In assessment, what you do is you create your own assessments, can be via say Google Forms kind of technologies, which are so easily available to us. Final column, you also try to write down the rubrics which you are going to use to assess the students beyond multiple choice questions. Now, this is a very simple thing. Now, let me come back, say, those subjects which have got chemistry, biosciences, two actual labs available right in our country where you can go and conduct experiments. There are even real-time labs also available, which are very small in number. You can have a connectivity via web window to do a real-time experiment also. Now, I tried this in one of the short-term courses which we conducted in our own university. Can people create this kind of a resource? And people came up with solutions for their own choice of subject. I'll just mention one subject. There is one paper which is being taught at the MPhil level called research methodology. This task was given to one of the participants, and that participant came out with a course of about 36 hours called out from the internet itself. Now you will say, what will happen when the teacher interacts with the student online? I think that is a great opportunity which gets real. Normally, you know what happens in even traditional classrooms, we never discuss. Discussion is not allowed, in fact. We have 250 students sitting in front of us, and we never discuss the things. Even right now, chats are available. You can just put a question at, and the teacher can always look at that. So can we not what we call flip the classroom through this kind of a small innovation? A wheel of learning, a very simple way of looking at this whole of the media. And I think with the passage of time, once you have these kinds of, what you call innovative level, these can be introduced to the students also. But definitely there is one thing which is the core issue. And the core issue is the connectivity. In the program itself, we lost the connection about five, six times. Now, this is the state of connectivity. And to talk about these solutions, I think we have to have a very robust, connectivity which should be available. And it should not be available to us only in, say, metros or only in big cities. I talked about the heterogeneity, rural India, say urban India, which is off. We need to have that connectivity, but people need to pay for the bandwidth. That is also a big question mark, which we need to really address. That is going to pay when it's, who is these kinds of things going to support them? So, we now should start very seriously looking at. And I think challenge is great. The challenges always come, bring opportunity also. And I think ample opportunities which are unfolding with us. We only need to have, very big, it doesn't have much money to create this. I'll stop here regarding this.
Thank you, Dr. Ahluwalia, for illustrating your answer with a beautiful example and raising the motivation of the teachers that not all is lost. As they say, necessity is the mother of invention. So I think crisis is the mother of innovation.
Or somebody else is going to
question. With this note, I would...
Are you able to listen to me?
Doctor, I would like to invite Dr. Madhukar.
Professor Kasir.
Dr. Madhukar to share his views on what is the way ahead in this situation.
Thank you for the second opportunity, both to Sakshi and Dr. Neha. I have heard almost all of them, and I think all views have an important role to play in our IG. There's no doubt on that. See, as you all know, it is education is in our concurrent list of the constitution. So it's a state subject as well as a central subject. That itself creates a lot of dichotomy that I will not get into that because that's a larger issue. Now, let us look at what we are talking about. See, before COVID, there was issues of teaching learning. Transmission, evaluation, these issues continued. In fact, if we go from one part to other part in India, whatever you call quality, even as per the NAC definition and gradings, I could see a difference about 20 years from one part of the country to another part of the country. You move from, and there is pockets of excellence. Maybe I agree with him, like you cannot take Delhi, Bangalore, Mumbai, Mysore and say this is quality of education. And in fact, I disagree with that concept. That's different. So anyway, that is also part of our system. We cannot ignore it. Now I tell you, I am not very concerned about online learning or face-to-face learning, etc. It's all platform because online is itself not learning. Online is a platform. See, this confusion of online learning means learning is a different concept as Professor Jawar. It is a platform. How do you use the platform is an innovation. How do you use the platform to make student learn is an innovation. That is a different category. We have to sit together to put that innovation together. Rather than comparing online is better than offline, I don't want to get into that conversation. Because it is not, some has some advantage, some has another advantage. And who is to decide? If you think Delhi or Bangalore or Ahmedabad is going to decide, we are completely off guard. It is not going to happen like that. I cannot have a Bangalore model and implement in Kanpur as had a Ahmedabad model and implement in some 24 Paraganas in West Bengal or in Northeast. It is not going to work. The issue that has to come, Professor Jawar clearly said it, and I go with what is that we have to give autonomy to institutions, make them autonomous. They will select what type of evaluation you have to do. Anyway, now all universities in five of large-scale standardization has happened because localization will create inequality. And there may be, people may not be serious in delivering their education, so we have to monitor. That is monitoring. Monitoring is basically a system driven out of distrust. We don't trust you. I will not trust Dr. Neha, madam, what she does in college. I will come and check. That is how our systems are. Came from British time and how that is how it has been strengthened. Basically, you see all our systems works on lot of distrust. our examination system, flying squad, running squad, what squad, for whom you're sending that squad to find some student copying or something like that. Where is it? It is a total distress. We have distress in the system itself. So when the moment there's a distress, all your policies are distress-based. You see any policy of government, you send one circular and say you report whether that has been done. If that is the way, it will not work. All institutions has to be given autonomy. And now 10 evaluation, I read 15 subjects in engineering. I don't know, one subject you evaluate based on assessment. Another subject you do as year-end exam or whichever online exam. Why should every subject be done in the same, evaluated in the same way? I don't see any reason that every subject needs to be evaluated in the same way. Some subjects can be evaluated online. You do that. Some subjects needs some face-to-face. You do that. Some needs assignment. You do that. Because the standardization is what creates a problem. In fact, I was listening to Professor C.N. Rao, who said, why India is not getting on the top at science level? He says our examination system kills off of it. Everybody, if you know, everybody, why should even in management, the portfolio management, that, this, why should everybody do the same, do only an errand exam? Some you give four assignments, three subjects is enough. You take three subjects for year-end exam, others you do through assignment. Yes, it becomes complicated a little. That will, if you centralize, it becomes too complicated. You have to, in fact, localize this. Give institution, yes, you are autonomous, you give your degree. It will be monitored or controlled for quality by an external organization. In fact, the new education policy is something related to that, but how it get implemented is a different issue. I don't know about that. It has to be a draft policy which says we have to, there should be no affiliated college in the country today. In the next 10 years, that is what they say. I think it is a good step forward. But even now, what autonomy means in many parts of the country is only you can handle 20% of the subject. If I have physics, an autonomous college can only change 20% of the syllabus. And this concept of syllabus completion itself is a different, is a kind of a negative one. So we have to look at it in a holistic fashion. But I say autonomy, 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 and allow education institutions to do its job. If some perish on the way, let it perish. Instead of making everybody standardized, which will not happen. Because the global movement will take you somewhere. Unless you try to diverge, I don't see anywhere in the world where everything, I don't see anybody saying that Cambridge and Harvard should be equal. And when you give first class, second class, third class for a student from a same accredited institution, what do you mean? All three are same quality or all three are different quality? What is your classification to do with an accreditation process? So it is more complex. I think we should allow ground realities to come into picture and allow some syllabus can be on a general thing. And evaluation need not be done for every subject you teach. Some subject you don't do. He will learn on his own. And teaching learning is one aspect I feel at the university level. It is more to do with how he, you build a capacity for him to learn. I think Aurobindo said long back, you cannot teach anything to anybody. You can only create an environment to learn. And in fact, you see our education system, 50% of the time is on meetings. Meeting means meeting, meeting, meeting. In fact, C.V. Raman in BHU address, convocation address said in when he was alive, what's 50 years back, it is time that we concentrate on teaching, learning, and do other, make other activities like meeting, etc. Stop calling meeting. This is kind of a distribution mechanism and kind of a safety wall we have created in the system. Meetings is a safety wall because you don't want to take an individual, this leadership problem. That is a problem here. Leadership problem is rampant here. That's why you have a meeting mechanism. So that the committee said, You can take advice from the parent, but you should show leadership. As mentioned by the committee, this is followed. So this system, to my opinion, not work. We have to give autonomy to all institutions, and some will try, some will may not try, but there you can have your own mechanisms to put it up or put it down. And don't try to say Bangalore model, Delhi model will be in Bihar and Orissa and all this will not work. Thank you.
Thanks
for the opportunity.
Yeah, and very rightly, as you pointed out, that online is a platform, right? It's not the methodology that you're using to train. It's basically a platform that you're using to train, and that could be online, face-to-face, or any other. How you use that platform to share or the knowledge or train people, your participants, your students, through pedagogy or andragogy, irrespective, is up to all different institutions. A big thanks to all the speakers. We will come to the closing note, but before that, I would like to highlight that it's been a great learning experience for all of us, and excellent responses from our viewers as well. Panel members have highlighted the digital divide in our country, the lack of in-class discussions, and several other challenges that we are facing. The lack of being able to easily replicate and disperse content through different platforms, whether it's online or face-to-face, keeping application in mind. That's one of the biggest challenges that has been impacting the quality in our country today. Another point that was highlighted was the lack of knowledge of robust technology like LMS platforms and other different learning platforms that we have today, or training methodologies. So from challenges to opportunity, I think the pandemic has forced us to rethink the education system in the country, to reevaluate the current and the future of higher education. And just like Dr. Madhukar said, when we change how we are running everything in the nation today, in the education industry, some will thrive, some might not, but something new will come up. That's an entire process which always happens, and it's an evolution process. So the question that we would want to ask is, could this be our watershed moment in the higher education system, right? All right, so before closing, I would want to invite all our panel members to share their views on the profession, teaching as a profession, right? How do we make it a more lucrative profession? How do we make sure that the bright minds in the country are actually expected to join in, or make this one of the top priorities instead of making it one of the latter priorities once what they wanted to achieve or what they wanted to move into did not work out? I would want to start with Dr. Ahluwalia.
Okay, thank you very much. I think this is a very interesting question. Let me put it like this. Teaching at a higher education institution level is not that badly lucrative, you know. It's reasonably lucrative, I would put it like that. It's not that there is no money in this. But, you know, why young minds don't want to come here? That's the big question to which we really try to look at. The reason is they see how we as teachers conduct ourselves in the environment on the campuses. And I think they get put off because of the role models which they see working in the campuses itself. I'm really trying to be very critical about ourselves only. When they see that, you know, there is no challenge here, the people are, you know, just doing routine things, no innovations are coming, there is no you know, new idea which gets floated into the classroom. What will I do in this kind of a system? They look for not just money. They look for those possibilities also, which can make them do something challenging itself. This is a very important point. And that is the reason your people will say, okay, I would like to go to become, say, an IAS officer, because I will get a lot of opportunity to change the society there. Though in education, you in fact impact society in a very big way, but those young minds, they don't see that kind of a challenge operating in our system itself. I think this is the biggest challenge, to make them see that there are lots of opportunities to contribute to the society and the campuses itself. This is one thing, which is very, very crucial. Second thing is the kind of, you know, politics which is killing our education systems. people know who is going to come as faculty somewhere before the interviews itself. So there is no question of quality coming into the campuses as faculty. They already know that here is a person who will be pushed into the system, even if he has got no credentials to be part of that kind of a system. This also puts off those people who are highly creative, who would like to be in the campuses, but they find that they have no maibaps there sitting who can really push them in. I'm trying to be very blunt, but this is a reality of the system itself. So I think we need to really somehow, you know, as we are seeing, autonomy is one of the solutions. Okay, very good. And right in my beginning remarks also, I said, who is the most crucial person who can change the thing? I remember one small anecdote from Homi Jahangir Bhavaji. You know, when he was asked to establish what we call Bhava Atomic Research Center now, he started that in the outhouses of Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. And, you know, some fellow came, then he said, what are you going to do? You are going to start atomic energy program in outhouses? What is this? And he gave a very interesting reply. He said, I want to give that fellow a table and chair. And if this fellow will be capable, he will be able to create all those things around him. How right he was. BARC is a success story because of that kind of a vision. We should not forget that. I think these are my remarks, and I think I'm very happy to be part of this panel. It was great listening to the very, experienced panelists in this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing your input, Dr. Ahluwalia. I would now want to invite Dr. Madhukar to share your opinion on the teaching profession. I think there are new. Dr. Madhukar, your mic is on mute.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, my view on this is, I agree with Professor Ahluwalia that the entry barrier is quite very sticky. The entry barrier is sticky, I agree with what he said. The other part is, see, there is something like, I don't know, maybe at least people who are more flexible. I have not seen any college or engineer going to a campus for campus recruitment. This may be a small issue, but still, why don't any institution which can take faculty, appoint faculty, at least with some level of freedom, don't do a campus interview where everybody, all and sundry from the computer industry, everybody comes there and does a campus interview. We need to do that. And this whole pattern of, even you see our case studies, you always say case study of Harvard or Cambridge or something. Why is, I have not seen a case study of Indian Institute of Science, how it was built. And in fact, Ahluwalia is upset about Bhabha Atomic Research Center. Why there is no case study of these things? We don't have our own case studies. Why? Except for that somebody came from abroad and said Dabbawala of Mumbai should be a case study. We never thought it should be a case study till then. So there is no, it is kind of a, if you see, somebody, a professor, how is a higher education professor? He's an old man, you show an old man, and a professor as an old man, and you always look at it as a professor which is attached to an old person who is sitting in a chair and just about doing nothing kind of a impression that is created. And I do think there is, in this type of a world, too, for a younger generation, who are miles apart from our thought process. In fact, I could say the communication channels between our teaching faculty and the younger generations who are coming into the systems are miles apart. That I can say, because I know my daughters who were in the age group who were talking about all this thing. They said, if not for attendance, I don't think we need to go to the college. And they were studying in one of the best colleges in Bangalore. So this is the impression they carry. And in fact, in one case, my daughter asked me, she showed one A grade college and said, if this college is A grade, why that is B grade? So this, we are creating an impression that only left outs will go there. That is the impression that goes into the minds of the young people. We should always tell them, all your life you are with young people. I don't have seen this tagline anywhere in any advertisement. You should say, all your life you are with young people. Isn't it such a wonderful thing to happen in your life? In which advertisement of teacher this tagline? I'm not particular about this tagline. It is there. In fact, I said I saw an advertisement yesterday, 2 days from one of the universities, particularly in Delhi area. They say the CEO of this company was a liberal arts graduate, and they have quoted three companies. I think many of you know which one I'm referring to. See, they have branding. Liberal arts course itself is being branded. That CEOs of these four company, or that maybe this is more of an urban phenomena. Even I'm looking at this as more of an urban phenomenon. But you cannot rule out that urban phenomenon exists. So an urban student will not be so much concerned about a rural aspect at his age. That is part of it. So what I'm trying to say is a glitter of glamour. I don't know why people may not agree with this word, but this needs to be presented with a Nobel Prize by Dr. Chandrasekhar was achieved when he was 40 years old. It is not known anywhere. Some packaging, whether you like it or not, I'm not saying exactly a commercial packaging, but some kind of a packaging that this is lucrative, you have career options, has to come out somewhere. That is my feeling. I don't know whether I'm right or wrong, but that's my feeling.
No, absolutely, Dr. Mahesa. I think we would agree there's a bit of a shift in narrative that needs to happen, right? In the interest of time, I would now invite Dr. Jawahar also to share your views on teaching as a profession, sir.
Yeah, I would like to begin from society. Society is corrupted. Society is corrupted. All parents want to put their kids into medical schools, engineering schools. Why? Is it to serve as a noble purpose, service? Now, are parents putting their kids in medical schools to serve like Mother Teresa or Florence Nightingale? Not. It is just simply a matter of commodity. It's a business money. You put 1 crore and hire your MBBS and get 2 crores. It's a commodity. And the Indian government has subscribed to the higher education to the World Trade Organization as a commodity. In the year 2005, the government of India had offered its higher education sector to World Trade Organization. How many of us know? I put a question, how many professors in this country know of this? When it was done 15 years ago, the World Trade Organization has said education is a commodity. It brought educational service into commodity as a trade. It is a trade where Indian government has subscribed to it. So that means Indian policies, the government, when in 2005 it has subscribed and succumbed to World Trade Organization, making education as a commodity and enter into trade, what all you can expect out of it? Whatever the policies the government is going to make, all are for trade. So in the trade, in the race, in the trade, all parents were corrupted because it's a trade, buying the degree, making more money out of it. The students nowadays are now taught in the schools. Most of the private institutions, even in government public institutions, they widely say that you get, you know, the placement, the concept of placement. I studied in England. I worked in the United States. I worked almost all parts of the world in our policy making, this, that, many things. I never heard a concept called a placement. Only in this part of the world, there is a concept called placement. And for that, Indian government is ranking, accrediting, awarding the institutions as the highest quality institutions. What do you mean by placement? In the placement, the tag is how much money your student is getting. Is in after graduation, how much salary he is going to drag. Money, you know? Money? How much innovation is he making? How much contribution he is going to serve to the society? These are not the measures. in the aftermath of their graduation, these are not the measures on the graduates. How much money is he going to make? 5 lakhs per annum. Yes, IIT is making 20 lakhs per annum, 30 lakhs per annum. High quality institutions in this country. If you make more money, more salary, more. So what as a parent you and we will do in the trade, in our race in the trade, we also want to put our kids into that. And we want to make money out of it. In United States, I tell you, I challenge you, the statistics is nobody wishes to go for medical studies. It is desire, purpose, desire, purpose. As a human being, I want to be a professor. I wanted to be a professor. I could have made millions as an engineer, successful engineer in the past. I made it. I had a lot of projects. I wished for it. How you will expect people to opt education as a career? Tell me now. When your policies are like this, when you are corrupting the society with, that's what in the first speech I told you, these are all the influence of the neoliberal market forces. The all corporate bodies, the market forces are interfering into the way in which education is rendered in this society, addressed in this society, in this country. This should be stopped once for all. The World Trade Organization should be thrown out of education. India has to come back, withdraw its offer to World Trade Organization, considering education as a trade. It should be withdrawn. Then you will make education as an optional career, is the first career for the graduates, for the students. You can look at into Finland. In Finland, no one works for study for becoming an IAS officer, another bad thing. IAS, IPS, they are the most cleverest people in this country. That is the impression. But a person who is making a patent and innovating and struggling his life and finding a solution for the society is considered as a less knowledgeable person in this country. This is to do with the ranking and the policies of this country. You change it. My son will be the first option. His first option for my son will be to become professor. And it will be the first choice of his career. All are linked. Society is corrupted. Parents are forced to put their kids into the trade of making a business in education, making money out of it. And the quality of education is assessed based on the salary my graduate is going to draw. This is the highly pathetic system in the world. Then I have to say that education is a business in this country. And it is the neoliberal, the market forces and the corporate forces are there.
Sir, we have lost you. Sir, we have lost you. Can I?
Hello.
Professor Nason, I have lost you. I have lost you. No, we cannot hear you. With your permission, may I move to? No, I'm not able to hear you. I think we have lost Professor Jawahar Nason in the middle of the argument that he was presenting. While we get him back, may I have Professor Ramesh Kasatwar to give us the closing remarks on how to change the narrative and make teaching as a more attractive option for the youth of this country. Professor, would you unmute your mic? Professor, would you please unmute your mic?
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yes, thank you very much.
I think Dr. Neha, you have given me the most difficult task of summarizing. Anyhow, see, the question was how to make a teaching more lucrative option and a first career sure for bright minds. Couple of issues are connected here. bright minds, profession of teaching, lucrative, and first career. I think this issue has become very, very complex today, very, very complex today. I don't think the time will permit me to address all issues today. The first thing I like to mention that today, our country, especially our country, because we are holding this seminar in India, I think we have lost, moreover, lost the image of guru for a teacher. Earlier days, the teacher was a guru. Today, I don't think teachers are treated as a guru by the student. Majority, I'm saying majority. Let's not go more than that. Secondly, everything we are trying to compare in terms of money. How much I earn? Where do I earn? There are cases today, evident everywhere, normal colleges, that teachers, besides teaching in the college, they also teach in the coaching classes to make more money. They don't cover the syllabus in the classroom and they advise students to join their coaching classes outside. Money. So money has become another very, very bad today, worst factor, which is not allowing. The next factor. Now imagine, I just want to make a small statement here, fact. I think all of us know here this is a fact. In India, where salary is assured, let's connect it to government aided or government college, salary is assured, performance is not assured. Salary is assured, but performance is not assured. I gone to travel to like Madhukar, I travel to more than 200, 300 colleges and universities across India, especially in government universities, government aided or something. Performance is not assured. There is no measure for assured by the faculty. Now, another side of it, where performance is demanded, the salary is not assured. I think today this condition has taken, I want to take attention to slightly different sector where we are working on a private enterprise, privatized higher education today. Performance is demanded. You have to perform, you have to do so many duties, you have to do so many, but the question comes, salary is not assured. There are cases, all of us, only question, who will talk? I will like to express myself on this through this webinar today. There are colleges and institutions in India today where salary is stopped in the month of February or March. There are cases in Pune, I am in Pune now, there are cases, whole world knows about it. The salary is not paid for 7 months, 8 months, 9 months in a year. How do you expect teacher to be effective? How do you call that teacher? How will he teach? How will he go to the classroom with happiness? And he'll ensure that learning success because he's worried all the time, worried about his home. There are cases in India, I can, if allowed to give, I can name minimum 30 or 100 institutions where teachers are paid 100 rupees salary, say 100 rupees. And we have to believe that more than 30, 40, 50% salary taken back by the promoters of the institution. So this is the case. I don't think teachers are respected in India today. They are least respected. He should be allowed. Now, secondly, why should teacher be allowed to retire? My next question is, scientists don't retire. Businessmen don't retire. How can teacher be allowed? Okay, teacher be allowed superannuation. But in India, can you allow the teacher to teach till he or she remain effective in teaching? It is not an age. I don't think today 60, 65 is the age now. I don't think. Professor Ahluwalia, myself, we all cross the age of 70 now. But we still can contribute. I remember the case where I sent a proposal to one of the vice chancellor of a central university. He said, sir, I will assign this job to one of my HOD. Okay. I spoke to HOD. HOD said, sir, I don't have a manpower with me. What do? I don't have a manpower. Central University don't have manpower. Okay. Then how to get a manpower suiting to the qualification laid down by central universities? Immediately I shot the letter, I shoot the letter, 3 pages recommendation to UGC, head of the UGC today. And that's the time there was AIU was conducting a special conference on Central University Vice Chancellor. I gave a point that why don't you waive up the condition of age, especially for teachers in Central Universities. I don't think my letter was even acknowledged by UGC or by AIU, by anybody else. I think in India I require today old people, not, I'm not saying old people, the people who can still teach, they should be allowed to teach till they can teach and they remain effective. I think these are a few of the things will bring back the glory of the profession of teacher today. I'm using the word glory. We have lost this word glory. Now it has become profession. We are, now somebody has just mentioned that yes, teacher is responsible to create doctor. He is responsible to create engineer. He is responsible to create commerce. He is responsible to create businessman. But I don't think he is responsible to create teacher. I want to express through your medium today, believe me, for the last 7 years, I am trying my best to start an academy somewhere for quality of teaching. Quality of teaching. Today, teacher is not important. The quality of teaching is important. Today, we see teacher is today assessed by his qualifications, number of paper published, number of this done, number of this done, blah, 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 blah. He's a good teacher. Can he teach? The art of teaching is different than a teacher. So I think all these factors should be considered. So I think this, whatever few points I could tell, this will bring back the glory of the profession of teaching, teacher today. Teacher, back to the days of guru. That's what I want to say. Thank you, Dr. Neha.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kasapar. Professor Nason, we lost you while you were still, no, I think we lost you when you were talking about a few things. Presented. Would you like to continue, please?
Yeah. So because of that kind of commercialization of education, and the invasion of trade into the education sector, and the influence of the major actors, the regulators, like the governments and the government, the market forces, and the other willful segment of the society, all are influencing the society and paving the way for the education to grow in a more business conditions, not in the in a rightful educational context. So that one, say, considering these pathetic conditions, I feel that, say, we have to now consider also the other contemporary best practices elsewhere. So why in United States a professor is a highly wanted job in US? And also, we all are aware of, go to Finland, people are talking about Finland. The highly, highly paid profession in any part of the world and in within the Finland is also the teacher. Every child you go, more than 80% of the child, their best, you know, their first option is teaching career. And they start from the 10th grade onwards. And in the 12th grade, during the secondary studies, and they decide that they want to go for education because education is a noble service. The society is that way. And the country is that way. The policy has been conducive that way. So that means all are conducive. And society is, the education is driven by the society there. Who is doing curriculum? Professor Madhukar said very properly, you give autonomous. So the point is, it is locally driven, globally addressed. It is driven locally, but globally addressed. Led by the society. The society drives the educational process in Finland. And teachers are groomed the best possible way and with all, you know, 360 degrees. They have the attitude. Attitude is also there. And the policies and the plans that they implement and the schemes that they evolve and the mechanisms of education and the system that they introduce and fine-tune day by day, all are, you know, conducive so that the attitudes are connected and the culture, academic culture is there, and people are having highest esteem for the teaching profession. So the teachers, the graduates, the students are looking for the first choice in Finland is teaching profession for all kids. Whereas many part of the world, even in United States, the highly capitalistic, commercialized part of the world, where it is not medicine or more engineering and other money-making careers. It is diverse. You go and ask people, or say, you know, people would say, I want to be a sociologist. I want to be a psychologist. There in the United States, can you see a kid coming here, coming to us and telling that I want to be a sociologist and psychologist in this country? No. That first thing is becoming IAS, IPS. What is those sort of jobs? They are all bureaucratic jobs. We are liking bureaucracy. We don't like noble professions. We don't like service. So this is the culture. This is the society. And that is the kind of governance and policymakers and the governance in this country we have. So all are corrupting the education sector. So in order to make education as the first lucrative and attractive career in this country, we have to revise everything. We have to inculcate the right culture in the society, and parents and the society people all have to be driven in a proper way. All have to be, you know, made aware of what is right, what is wrong, and exposed to, so that they will make up their mind. So that kind of fine-tuning, tweaking is needed highly in this country. As an end note, I would like to quote that education should be brought back to the society. It should be driven by the society, because education is primarily, has been primarily, time immemorial, since the evolution of the humankind, it is a social function. And the knowledge is nothing but the human experience, based on the human endeavors, based on the challenges and questions the human society faces. It comes up with all endeavors that becomes the knowledge. So when knowledge is human experience, then all walks of experience should be harvested into the educational process through the curriculum process. And that kind of educational system will only be reflective of what the society needs and what the country needs, what the region needs. So that kind of educational process, I think that it is to do with the philosophy. We lost the philosophy of education, and we have been derailed. The education has been derailed from the purpose, its intended purpose. So that means that we have to empower, liberate education to do its intended job, and the policymakers of this country.
Thank you, Dr. Jawahar, for a very passionate argument. Thank you, all the panelists, for giving your concluding remark. And now may I invite... Ms. Sakshi, the founder of Provis, to conclude the panel discussion.
Thank you so much, Dr. Neha. Unfortunately, I got dropped off in between. I'll probably revisit the video and watch the end concluding remarks from all our panelists. But a big thank you to all of you for being here, for being part of the discussion. Honestly, it's been an excellent learning experience for myself as well. Coming from the education background, or training background rather, more from a corporate perspective, it's given me personally a lot of different insights, and the views that we've received from our audience have also been very, very positive. Thank you so much for joining us and making time to join us for the discussion today. And Dr. Neha, I would also really want to thank you, especially for being here and helping us host the session for the day. And a big thank you to all our audience for viewing the discussion and for joining us.
Sakshi, can I take a few minutes only, if you permit me?
Sure, Dr.
Last. Okay. Thank you very much, all the audience and everybody. I just want to make a small tell everybody, to all the audience, myself, Dr. Ahluwalia, Jawahar, Dr. Madhukar, We all are active members of a group called Friends of Quality. This group was established by me about 2-3 years back, and there are members from all parts of segments of society who want to contribute, define, redefine what is called quality in the society. This is what I want to announce, that we all are, luckily, we all are the members of the same group called Friends of Quality. Thank you, Sakshi.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ramesh. And well, that brings us to the end of the session. And thanks a lot once again to all of you. I would be now ending the broadcast.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.